So coffee houses provided them with an alternative meeting place to talk, just in have discussions. What started happening was the Sultan Murad IV, grew aware of these and was afraid that they would start to overthrow him. So he declared drinking coffee a capital offense in 633 because of this. And this is a very common theme with just coffee houses in general. So he outlawed coffee houses, and he disguised himself as a peasant and roamed the streets with his broadsword and killed anyone who smelled like coffee. So that was the very first instance of coffee houses. It had caused people to rebel against authority. So that was the first instance. The second instance was in England. The Pasco Rosé opened, and it was the first coffee house in London, and it opened in 1652. English coffee houses were known for having tables covered with newspapers, where guests would come to discuss and write the news. In Oxford, the coffee houses around there had begun being known as penny universities, because people who went to Oxford would go into these coffee houses and just discuss what they had learned that day and with other students. And they were also discussing among people who just didn't go to college, who were just there, and they had access to these intellectual debates in these coffee houses without having to pay for college. And so that's why they became known as penny universities, because the price of the coffee was only a penny. And so that's all it costed to attend the debates. The Grecian coffee house, also in London, was a meeting place for members of the Royal Society, including Sir Isaac Newton, who once dissected a dolphin inside the coffee house, and other members of the Royal Society, which I'm pretty sure during our Enlightenment, almost everybody was part of the Royal Society. On June 12, 1672, Charles II issued a proclamation to restrain the spreading of false news and licentious talking of matters of state and government, which basically outlawed coffee houses because they were talking about politics. A quote from this proclamation is, "Men have assumed to themselves a liberty, not only in coffee houses, but at other places and meetings, both public and private, to censure and defame the proceedings of state by speaking evil of things they understand not." Charles II's father was beheaded during the English Civil War, which is why he was paranoid about this. And so, because he was paranoid, he employed his Secretary of State to embed a network of spies inside of coffee houses to stop people talking, basically. And in December 1675, he outlawed coffee houses, but that ban only lasted 11 days because of how coffee houses had become like this huge part of education and social activity. In Germany, Frederick the Great also wanted to ban coffee for most of the same reasons, except he also did not want people to replace beer with coffee, because he thought of beer as being healthier and beer as being like the drink of Germany. And coffee was slowly replacing that. And so another quote by him is, "It is despicable to see how extensive the consumption of coffee is. If this is limited a bit, people will have to get used to beer again. His Royal Majesty was raised eating beer soup, so these people can also be brought up nurtured with beer soup. This is much healthier than coffee." Boston Tea Party, people started drinking coffee more in favor of tea, because tea was had become a representation of Britain. So coffee became a patriotic drink. And coffee houses were also meeting places for the Sons of Liberty during the Revolutionary War. And then lastly, in France, coffee houses during the Enlightenment were meeting places for people like Rousseau, Diderot, and Voltaire. And then during the Bastille, the storming of the Bastille, revolutionaries plotted beforehand in a coffee house, and they sheltered in coffee houses after. So.
Amazing. Good job. Good job. Comments?